What is prayer? Prayer is an offering up of our desires unto God for things agreeable to His will in the name of Christ, with confession of our sins and thankful acknowledgement of His mercies.
Question 98 of the Shorter Catechism, and here we now reach the home stretch for those who have been working their way through these videoed classes. We are now on the final segment of the Shorter Catechism. So this last section, if we look at the kind of the bigger portion of the last section, it's dealing with the means of grace, the means God's appointed to bring grace to His people, the Word, sacraments, and prayer. And we've covered the first two. We now come to prayer itself. And this is going to take us all the way through to the end at question 107. There's going to be some introductory material on prayer itself. And then the last several questions will be devoted to an exposition of the Lord's Prayer, which is a model that God has given to guide us in our prayers. But here we begin with a simple question: what is prayer? And this is really a beautiful answer, very concise, very precise, and I think very heartwarming as well. Prayer is the offering up of our desires unto God. And that is a beautiful expression of what prayer really is. So it's the offering up our desires. Now, this has a few different components to it, right? It's, first of all, the idea of offering up something. So we not only have desires, but they are being directed heavenward. They're being taken to the Lord. So the things that are in our heart, the contents of our heart, are actually being dumped out or exposed and brought before the Lord. We are going not just to other people. We tend to have burdens, we tend to have excitement about things, and we're animated, and what do? We run to our spouse, we run to our siblings, we run to our friends, and we want to tell them about it. But the Christian in their life have this relationship with God that is first and foremost above and beyond all others. And that leads us to wanting to bring everything that's going on in our life to Him and to bring it before Him. Now, really, this question has a few parts to it, and some of this is expounded in what follows in the remainder of the Catechism. The first thing is it tells us the object. The object, the one that we're praying to, is the triune God of the Bible. So we're offering up our desires to God. This is a qualifier. It's excluding other things. So we're not praying, for example, to angels, nor are we praying to departed saints. The Bible would forbid both of those things. Prayer is an act of worship, and therefore it is to be given only to God Himself and not to be shared with any creature or anything outside of Himself. It's an act of worship. And so the Lord is the focus, our triune God. We are consciously coming into His presence. Now, unlike the angels and even unlike the departed saints, God is omnipresent. He's everywhere present, and He's omniscient. He's all-knowing. And so you can have thousands and thousands of Christians all over the world praying to Him at one time, and He is there and hears and receives and knows all of the details, unlike a creature could. So the Lord has omnipotence, so He's all-powerful. He's able to receive and answer according to His own will, all of those prayers. So the object is triune God, the triune God. The second thing, and this is the rule, and the rule of prayer is the Word of God. The next question will actually unpack this further. Prayer isn't just we're left to ourselves to kind of do and think and say whatever comes to our mind, right? The Bible talks about the fool just utters whatever is in his head. In Ecclesiastes, we're told that when we come before the Lord, we're to hold our tongue. We're not just to speak any vain thing, right? We're to come with sobriety and with reverence before the Lord. We need to be guided. And Scripture is the rule that guides us. So God gives us in the Bible direction, instructions. It's our instruction manual for prayer. God tells us the kinds of things that we are to bring to Him in prayer and how we bring those things to Him in prayer, what our expectations should be in bringing those things to Him in prayer. And so God's will, His revealed will in the Bible, provides guidance on what we ask for. So, for example, children, if you were to say, I'm going to pray that I could fly like a bird, the question would be, how does that conform to Scripture? Does God show us in His Word that it's His revealed will that men fly like a bird, that you flap your arms and you can take off and fly over the house and trees and so on? The answer is no. So there's no warrant for praying for that sort of thing. God's Word doesn't provide us with it. The third thing that we see is access. We'll come back to number two in the next catechism question. Access to the Lord, and this comes through Christ. So our access is in the name of Christ. The catechism makes this clear to us. For things agreeable to His will in the name of Christ. So here, if you look at the larger catechism, again, you'll see fuller material provided in questions 180 and 181, where this is unpacked a little more fully. What does it mean to have access to God? We often end our prayers by saying something like, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, amen, or many, many variations of that idea. Is that some sort of just magical formula? I mean, is that just a tradition that we attach to our prayers? And the answer is no. There's a reason that we use that kind of language in prayer. We are conscious of the fact that none can go into the throne room of God and beg audience with Him without the access provided in the person of Christ. So remember in Esther how Mordecai tells Esther, go to the king and, you know, get this edict to kill the Jews turned back. And she writes him back and says, listen, no one's allowed to go into the presence of the king without being summoned. And if you go into the presence of the king and he doesn't hold out his golden scepter, you're killed. Well, how much more with the living and true God, the God of glory, the God who has all of His majesty, right? We don't have a demand, a right. You know, we're not over God. He's not a lackey that we can beckon at our own haste and interest. No, the Lord Himself has undertaken as the great sovereign, the great king, and He said, I want you to come to me with all of your desires. I want you to have a warm reception into my presence. And in order for that to happen, I am providing the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ to accomplish that, the door through which we come into the Lord's presence, right? The Lord has ripped the veil, as it were. We're able to go boldly into the Holy of Holies. That throne is a throne of grace for His people. And we are able to go with boldness with all of the needs that we have into His presence. And so we're coming in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The fourth thing is our help in prayer, and that would be the ministry of the Holy Spirit. So just as we saw in the ministry of God's Word as it is read and preached and sung and so on, and in baptism and in the Lord's Supper, so in prayer. Prayer is made efficacious by the ministry of the Holy Spirit, who works in us and assists and helps us in this work of prayer. And of course, with that is the expression and exercise of faith, right? We don't have, Hebrews makes clear, no ability to expect anything from the Lord without asking Him in faith. The Larger Catechism deals with this in 178, question 178. So in Romans and in Galatians, the Lord provides for us, and in several other epistles, references to praying in the Spirit, to the Spirit interceding, to the Spirit's work and helping us in our weakness in prayer. And if you take these two things together, I think it may be helpful. We have two intercessors. First of all, we have an intercessor in heaven. Christ is interceding for His people. He's praying for us. And so as our prayers and praise are lifted, they go through the mediation of Christ and are purified and presented and made acceptable before God. So we have access through Christ. But then we have another intercessor. There's one in heaven. There's also an intercessor within us, the Spirit who indwells us, the third person of the Godhead indwelling God's people, intercedes within our souls on our behalf, assisting and helping us in our prayers. The fifth thing that the Catechism addresses is content. So the content of prayer, and here we can mention just a few things briefly, because some of this is covered later on. One would be adoration, and this is included in the idea that we're offering up our desires to the triune God. So you can't come before God without acknowledging who He is. And I would go so far as to say, and we'll address this in the Lord's Prayer, that this is in some ways the chief part of our content. We are given the privilege of adoring Him. But then the Catechism, a little more explicitly, speaks of our petitions. So this is the offering up of our desires that have been molded by God's will. Out of the heart, the mouth speaks, the Bible says. Well, we can tell a lot about where our heart is by what the content of our prayer is. Because our mouth is giving expression to what is in our hearts before the Lord. And so if we're coming to the Lord primarily with just a grocery list that deals with temporal issues, I need a raise, I need a new position at work, I need help with my schoolwork, I want to win the ball game that I'm in, I want to have this or that or the other thing, it tells us where our heart is. So our petitions should include the temporal needs that we have, our daily bread and our physical sustenance and so on. It's appropriate. But it also ought to include the things that pertain to God's interests, God's kingdom, and so on. Two more things that are given here. One is the confession of sin, and then thanksgiving. And these are spelled out explicitly in the Catechism. So again, if we're coming, we who are finite, fallen, sinful creatures before the presence of an infinite, holy God, then as we see Him by faith, we also begin to see ourselves, and we're made self-conscious of who we are in the presence of God. And therefore, it must include confession of sin. So proper prayer includes the expression. We're saying to God, we are owning our sin. We are looking at our sin, acknowledging our sin, expressing our sin as You do, Lord, as You see it. This is disobedience, transgression, iniquity. This is law-breaking. This is defilement. This is rebellion against You. And so we're coming before Him and we're acknowledging our sins, confessing them before Him. It's an important part of prayer. And then lastly, thanksgiving. It is you know, you think of a child, if a child's always asking for something, can I have this, can I have that, can I have this, can I have that, and that's all we ever hear out of their mouth, there's a problem there, right? If there's not expression of thanksgiving, of saying, thank you, I'm grateful for the things that have been given to me, you realize there's a heart problem. So it's true, so likewise with the Christian. We're coming to the Lord and saying, Lord, I am grateful for all that you have provided for me. And we can think in terms of the work of Christ, the ministry of the Spirit, his word that he's given to us, the ordinances, all of the spiritual blessings that we have and the forgiveness of sins and justification before the Lord and growth in grace and the eternal inheritance and on it goes, as well as thanking him for the temporal mercies that he's given to us. Thanksgiving is actually an expression of humility. When we thank someone, another person, we're humbling ourselves. We're saying, thank you for giving me something that I didn't have, or saying or doing something for me that I didn't deserve. And it's a way of coming humbly before the Lord. The Psalms are full of this, expressions of thanksgiving. And this attitude of gratitude is a means of really framing our heart with spiritual mindedness. So thanksgiving is also part of the content. So question 98, what is prayer? Prayer is an offering up of our desires unto God for things agreeable to his will in the name of Christ with confession of our sins and thankful acknowledgement of his mercies.